What I'm most excited about is just being in Louisiana. Like, I've never been there before, and being in New Orleans, like, I feel like it's... I actually want to learn how to say the word New Orleans correctly, for one. And just being there, I feel like there's so much history and stuff.
So.
Sweet. How about you?
Hi, I'm Dulac. I'm most excited about meeting the people from the Omaha tribe. And a lot of people say that Louisiana is kind of like a whole other country. So I'm excited to meet the people and learn about the culture.
From the University of Richmond. Right now we're smack dab in the middle of Tennessee somewhere. Just having some good times at Gus's Good Times. And it's great food. I had a chicken parmesan. It's unbelievable. Here the sandwiches are steamed. They're not baked. They're not just thrown together. They're steamed. It's a very unique thing. They've also had a lot of other unique experiences. They have been all sitting down in one car in one place. But lots of great tunes, great people, great stories. And I'm excited for more.
Cups of coffee, one Diet Coke, 20 hours, and a bunch of NSYNC, India RE, Backstreet Boys, Lauryn Hill later, and we are finally at the Dulac Community Center. It's been a long trip, and I'm really tired, and caffeine is starting to wear off, and I'm a little delirious, but it was all worth it, and I am really excited about all that this week will have in store.
My name is John. I'm acting like a director. No, I'm acting director of the community center here. So I first came here in 96. I was here to 2003. Came back just a year or so ago. And so I know y'all definitely want to start swinging some hammers and slapping some paint and getting to work.
All right. So the house is actually right behind the center. And now what you've been asking us to see if we can get a fresh coat of paint on it. Or where's my painting group at?
Oh, yeah. Well,
okay. So, and the others, what we'll do is we're actually going to build two boxes, a little 12 by 12 box that we're going to use for guarding. We have some dirt that's on the way. And then if we can build a 3 by 3 compost box. And that'll be behind the tool shed. So let me go get the painting group lined up and whatnot. And then I'll come back and we'll take care of the others as well that's going to be doing the building and stuff.
I'm not sweating, so.
Yeah, so I think it's like
White paint.
Then we can get to use the rubber satin latex. So that could be the white that's for the trim.
Yeah.
So we have a couple just lying around, but
Good morning, Tine.
Good morning.
What's up,
man? What's up? Getting old again.
Don't get that taken care of.
All right.
Mm-hmm. Give Monsieur Parfait.
Bon. Good like that. Got it down, but that girl like it's insane. Brother can't watch him put that girl down again. Late one night, hooking up with a couple of friends.
We get another flooding, and that's always possible. That it doesn't just take our box away. So if we can do that, it'd be fine. And then somewhere close as well, we can build the compost box. Just it could be as 3x3 or something similar to that size, but we probably want it to be about 5 or 6 foot.
Sometimes the Creator has a plan for you that you don't necessarily see for yourself, and so I ended up serving on the Tribal Council as a Tribal Council representative, secretary, treasurer, vice chair, and then chairwoman, and then under our new constitution, principal chief. And so it's been quite a blessing. We have been in the federal acknowledgement process for over 30 years. That has been quite a challenge as well. We filed what's called a petition for federal recognition. The documentation and stuff they want is insane.
How does that affect like the pride of the Houma Nation?
Doesn't really. I mean, I'm sure it would be a boost for us if we gained that federal recognition status. But for us, we're always going to be Houma. I don't need a seal of approval from the government to tell me who I am. I have my history, I have my culture, I have community, I have everything that a tribe has. The only thing that seal of approval from the federal government would allow me is opportunities that I don't have. Healthcare, housing, education, things that our people desperately need. But as far as feeling like I'm any less Houma because the federal government's not recognizing me, never a thought. The tribe itself has 17,000 tribal citizens. A lot of our elders speak only French. It's a Houma French, it's our dialect. It's not a, you know, it's not a Cajun French, it's not an Acadian French. It's part of our traditional Houma language mixed with French from when the French settlers came into the area. So it's a unique dialect, but there's language barriers there, educational barriers, right? Living along the bayous and along the coast presents its challenges. We suffer land loss at an alarming rate. We constantly are threatened with hurricanes, you know, now the oil spill. And so we've had quite a few challenges over our history, but even more so just in recent years. And so we were camped out with, you know, friends and family, and just in disbelief of what was happening. Once we saw it, it's like it just kept happening. You know, all the things, just when you thought it couldn't get any worse, then something else would happen. And so my husband's grandfather had an old general store, and it was like an old-time Walmart. It sold everything. And so it had been vacant for about 40, 50 years, but it had accumulated a lot of family stuff. One of our biggest contributors was Walmart. They really came through for us with this hurricane. I was fortunate enough to be able to be invited to fly over to some of our tribal communities. So we took our yard and we had what we call Tent City. And so people lived with us for almost a year. At any time, I could not tell you who was with me, but they would camp out, they'd pick like trees and they'd put all their little tents together. We had like universities and faith-based groups, doctors, lawyers, self-proclaimed hippies, you name it, they were all here. And we were really, really blessed because the people that came with pure heart and intention. I can't say enough about, you know, how much it meant to us.
This is
these other baskets that I just collected from other tribes, you know, that are there. So there's carvings and things and pottery and things down here. And then this is some of the bead work. And so my son does beading. When my little girl was younger, she was a fancy dancer. So you can incorporate all kinds of different designs. And so she was into Teletubbies. It shows you how old. Like, this was my daughter, who is now in a size 11 shoe. That was her moccasins when she was born. So my son, who is 24, that was his moccasins. So there's different type of dance styles. So one is, I'm Southern cloth. And so Southern cloth is more of a supposed to be graceful dance, not a lot of movement to it, shoulders back. It's kind of like walking in slow steps and bending your knees to the beat of the drum. Fancy dancing is more of a modern dance. You wear the bright colors, a lot of the bright beadwork, and there's a lot more movement to it. They also call it a butterfly dance. So you hold your arms out with a shawl, it's got fringe hanging, and you move your light, pointing your toes and moving your arms like the wings of a butterfly.
I laminated every article that I saw that had anything on the rosewood. I must have 50 pounds of laminates. And I challenge y'all, I'd love for y'all to take these laminates home and go through there and see if you find a single article on health issues with the people. Because nothing was written about it. I made no promises to anybody, okay? But the proof of the pudding, and this was my statement from the beginning, you know, if it works, it works. If it doesn't work, it doesn't work. But I can tell you, we had no idea it was going to work. It's been absolutely amazing. The only thing we'd ask you to do is just make fun. Mm-hmm. If you got somebody out there that's sick, just become their friend, their dog, get them their case, and get them over here to be treated.
Louisiana is losing roughly about a football field every hour of land. The land is so fragile here, you have to really look at the way the land was built. Our land was built from the Mississippi River, from sediment coming down the Mississippi River, and that was before the Mississippi River was dammed. You know, the spring floods would bring a lot of sediment to the area, and all that sediment would come down, and that's how South Louisiana was built. When they dammed the Mississippi River, all that sediment now goes off the Continental Shelf and doesn't help to replenish and rebuild the land. Well, we've cut off that lifeline where the river's not replenishing was being lost. And so the government and local, state, and federal governments looking at ways that we can start replenishing and help to at least try to bring some land back. You know, if not, we know we're not going to get it all back and replenish the coast like it once was, but how do we at least stop us from losing all that land and not at least trying to create some land? The fishing industry isn't back, so we're still seeing the effects of the oil spill. People, you know, confidence in the product and shrimp and crabs and fish is not there, and so the price on that is low. The amount of catch that people are catching right now is down. So the fishing industry is still down, but the oil and gas is rebounding. I mean, BP had one of the worst natural disasters, but I think this last quarter they still were able to profit $14 billion. So go figure. So they're doing fine, but the fishing industry is not.
To put a campsite, as you can see, they got some campers here. And when I was driving through, I seen this little house, and I approached the lady that used to live right here. And I asked her about it, and she offered me this house for little or nothing. My parents lived around the corner there for a lot of years. They were fishermen, and I guess I got small roots here. I've been here 12 years, and I probably spent $40,000 on this house. But I saved it from the termites and the storms, and I'm happy to be here. I'm embedded in the fishing industry over here. I buy a lot of shrimp. I own several restaurants in New Orleans. Ball Food and Spirit, if anybody ever wanting to come to New Orleans. You see, you got a good Christian community right here. It's mostly the people and the fishing industry that I like here. And a piece of cloth.
Yeah.
Take a shot of my trumpet boat. I'll be in the next couple of months. You can call me anytime.
Charter schools are. A lot of people have misconceptions about charter schools. They don't understand it. They're thinking it's, you know, the privatization of public schools, and that's not what charter schools are about. The essential difference is when you have a traditional school system, you have like a county, or what we call in Louisiana a parish, where it's a local school board. And that one school board sets a standard for all schools that are within its jurisdiction, within that county. So you take the power from that local principal that's in that school every day, that knows its students, that knows, you know, this isn't working, but it doesn't give them the power to actually make accommodations for their actual school. Instead, they have to go through the board. And the board doesn't like making exceptions for particular schools. So essentially they're saying is, we are giving you the freedom. If you think that the best way to get your students academically to succeed is to have, say, classroom hours from 7:30 in the morning to 5 o'clock and not the standard 8 to 3, go for it. But at the end of the day, if you are not producing results, we are taking away that right. So it allows schools the freedom to try to find ways of what's going to be best to succeed, and schools that are not producing, it allows the state or the board to come in and change it. Whereas in traditional schools, it's nearly impossible.
From sports to arts to student empowerment types of clubs, other than that, I work with volunteers, bring mentors into the school, basically any kind of community outreach.
Before we get started, Asha, do you want to just talk a little bit more about the Seeds Project?
So we are called the Seeds Project, and we are a student group from the University of Richmond. And we plan a spring break trip every year to New Orleans, where we learn about different issues of social justice. So anywhere where different groups of people are marginalized or just don't have like the same access to the things that everyone should have. And so we like to kind of explore these issues through service and through talking to different people and living in different places. So we're here with you guys at Langston Hughes, which is exciting. We've been at Tulane University. We've been doing some home repair projects in the St. Bernard district, and we love New Orleans a lot. So just from coming here year after year and hanging out with different people from all different communities. So we're really excited to be here.
You can take what you're learning in the classroom and apply it to the activities that you're pursuing outside of the classroom as well, and the breadth is huge. So you can just take whatever you want and pretty much just do it.
You can go to college with the mindset that, you know, that it's going to be provided for. So even if you're in a financial situation which doesn't really allow you to provide for your college tuition, you don't have to look at loans primarily to be your source of tuition, because financial aid at a lot of schools will definitely recompensate you for that.
Can we raise our hands if we're getting a lot of money from the university to like show?
Yeah, for sure. Yeah.
I think the coolest thing about making friends at college for me was just meeting people that were nothing like me and finding things that we had in common all the same.
Another second one awakes his next door brother. Three awaken, rise a town and turn the hope.
My name is Al Carter.
Okay. Yeah.
My name is Derek Alonzo.
My name is
Desmond Adams.
My name is James Cameron.
Okay.
My name is David Berry.
That's excellent. Could you tell me the classy chant? Do you know how that goes?
Dream it, do it, be it.
No.
In unison?
Dream it, do it, be it.
Before the flood, New Orleans schools were already in pretty terrible shape. It's been said that the flood is actually one of the best things that has happened for the school system. It was tragic for everyone involved, whether you were involved with the schools or not, but it really made everyone step back and reassess the systems that were in place for education. We had one of the schools that was worst in the district, worst in the parish, worst in the state, and the state was worst in the country. What the flood did was it made everyone reassess all the systems that were in place, but the rebuilding began immediately in terms of getting the education system where it needed to be. So like a lot of the other schools in the district, Langston Hughes is very emphasizes very strongly a college-bound mentality. The classrooms are named after the alma mater of the teacher at that classroom, and depending on when each class is projected to graduate high school, they're named after the years. If their teacher is from Duke, they would be Duke class of 2016. This college mentality, it's not what every student needs, and of course like the education can't be standardized to every student individually, but I feel that for a K-8 this college emphasis is good for a student because it makes them think of their life beyond school. It makes them think of their classes not just as like grades, A's and B's, but kind of using that knowledge in a real world situation, in a real world environment, and not even thinking about college, but we include the world beyond. The motto here is dream it, do it, be it, and the mission includes preparation for the best high school, to be able to get into the best college, to prepare them for the world beyond.
Where are we?
So New Orleans is a neighborhood kind of city, right? And what you'll notice, I don't know if you noticed since your time being here, is that it's also very, it's a neighborhood city where neighborhoods of different socioeconomic statuses are lumped together, right? So right now we are called, in an area called the Bywater.
Right here, Houma's would be what? To buy $250,000?
At least, yeah.
Across that main street, you're talking about maybe $50,000 for homes that look exactly alike. Historically, New Orleans itself, when we look at the map, we sit in between the Mississippi River and Lake Pontchartrain, and there's a system of canals that come in from the lake. So just like you're how you're about to see that canal, there's canals like that on various different parts all over the city, and that's why all of those levees breach except for maybe like one or two of them. The levees of the river did not breach. All the breaches came from the lake being over flooded, coming into the canals, putting pressure on them and breaking. Yeah. So that is why you had such amount of destruction around the city.
Over 80% of the residents in the upper ninth, in the lower ninth ward, owned their homes. Mm-hmm. They weren't like lavish homes, but they were homeowners. And so that actually has caused a lot of the lack of rebuilding to happen, because a lot of the homeowners weren't required. Once you paid out of your house, you're not required to pay for flood insurance. You're required to keep, you know, your house insurance, your home insurance. But there was a decision that was made that the flooding that damaged the house was only going to be covered by flood insurance. And so if you owned your house, you already paid it off, no one really wanted to continue to pay flood insurance, because we were like, it's never going to flood around here. And so there was no insurance for them. And so that means that you literally have to come up with your own money to rebuild your own house.
For decades, we had what was called the levee board that were supposed to be on top of making sure that the levees are actually up to code and a standard, and that levee board was supposed to have been stepping in and say, hey, okay guys, it's time for us to do improvements to the levees, and they did not. Things that they knew and had known decades before and should have made the changes, they did not. And had they made the changes, most of the levees, can't say with 100%, but majority of the levees would not have failed had they did their job years prior. For months, two and a half months for the most part, before the water actually got pumped out of the city. So that is essentially what the biggest part of the problem as well, is that 2 months of water just sitting. And then you have mold problems and whatnot. So that is why houses, if they weren't gone to begin with, they had to be torn down, because you physically cannot have lived there.
Let's say this is your home. Everything you ever owned, every memory, your first drawing from kindergarten, right? All that is gone, all the pictures you ever owned. And so it's really hard to come in and see that And then it's even harder to actually, you know, you literally have to trash your whole house. And then the worst part, I would say, is the smell. Like, yeah. When stuff was sitting, I mean, you left with your fridge full of
in
stuff.
August.
You know, August. You know, it's hot and it's just like soggy, nasty, rotten stuff. Mm-hmm. And so working in these conditions to gut someplace like this is terrible. You still don't have electricity, still hot as hell. So it was tough for everybody.
Because they were the business owners, and had they not chosen to come back, that means their entire employees could not come back. So then you had these people that had to make the gut-wrenching decision of, do I pick up and move to another city? Or do I be back a part of it? And you know, what them and their families had to go through too. So that's why, man, like, it hit everyone on all different levels. So not only do you have your own pressures of your family, but literally there is pressures on a few people's shoulders of actually getting the city up and running.
So the problem that the city's had is that you may not necessarily know where the person that owns this house is, and it may not necessarily have connected with the city. And our city hall was also very devastated. So, you know, records were lost and all this chaos. So it's really, it's a lot of really bureaucratic failures to really kind of figure out what's going on.
For the first, especially 2 years, there was nonstop church groups, school groups coming in, and New Orleans definitely cannot be here without volunteer work that came in. So like what y'all are doing, like obviously there's still a need that you see for work to get done, and a lot of the rebuilding has been on volunteers.
Definitely.
So.
And Steve will be back next
year. Yay!
Thank you.
One man awakes, awakens another. Second one awakes, his next door brother. Three awaken, rise a town and turn the whole place upside down. Many awake will cause such a fuss, and finally wakes all of us. One man awakes with dawn in his eyes. Surely then it multiplies. Surely then it multiplies.
Delta, Sigma, 1, 2, 3, Ruby! Da-da-da! When the seeds in the soil, ma, drop it like it's hot, drop it like it's hot, drop it like it's hot, when Mike starts cat daddy,
drop it like hot.
We got the seeds and the money and the something, and the something, and the something, and New Orleans!